the digital delight of jazz and what's more on WFDU HD2, T-Neck.
Lift every voice and sing, till earth and heaven ring. Ring with the harmonies of liberty. Let our rejoicing rise high as the listening skies. Let it resound loud as the rolling sea. Sing a song full of the faith that the dark past has taught us. Sing a song full of the hope that the present has brought us. Facing the rising sun of our new day begun, let us march on till victory is won.
What's going on? What's going on, good folk? You know what it is. It's Jack Dappa Blues. This is Wednesday, and you know we takes over the airwaves. We takes over the streaming airwaves with nothing but blues, 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 and more blues. Now, I'm getting Big Bill on the phone right now. For all of you who've tuned in to listen to my interview with Big Bill Morganfield, just so you know, as you tuned into your favorite public radio or TV station, enjoying a great show, and suddenly they break away to give you 15 to 20 minutes of solid begging during their fundraising efforts, what do you do? Chances are you tune out, especially if you already donated. Well, it's Fundraising February here at WFDU, and this year we're trying something different because we want you to stay tuned in as we grow our audience. That's why we're having a kinder, gentler Fundraising February. We are not going to go on and on beating you up until you either surrender or turn away. No, we're not. The music will play with only short suggestions to support the radio station you love. Call 201-692-2012 and leave your name and number on the voicemail. One of us will call you back to complete your generous donation. Or you can do it yourself with our secure online giving form at wfdu.fm. Just press the donate button to get started. Oh, and don't forget to let us know which show you want to support. And if you support Jack Dapper Blues, you know what to do, because when you come here, you learn them blues. I'm going to play a song real quick while I get Big Bill on the phone. I will be right back at you, good folks, because you know what we're doing here.
Thought I'm on my way to the big house, and I don't even care. I'm on my way to the big house, yeah, and I don't even care. I make it lifetime, and I may get to leg the chair. I wouldn't mind going to the big house, but I've got to stay there so long. I wouldn't mind going to the big house, yeah, but I've got to stay there so long. They got me excused for murder when I ain't done nothing wrong. Thought I ain't got no money, and a job is hard to find. I ain't got me no money, and a job is hard to find. I've been out of luck so long, I ain't got one lousy dime. Lord, I once had a woman, and she did not mean me no good. Lord, I once had a woman, that woman did not mean me no good. And she gave me so much trouble, I had to move from a neighborhood.
What's going on? What's going on, good folks? And yet again, welcome to the show, and welcome to my special guest. Today, we are speaking with the legendary, living legend, son of a legend. He has a new album out right now called Bloodstains on the Wall. We're going to get to talking about that and Black Shucks Records. I like the name of that. Would you all please give a nice welcome for Big Bill Morganfield? What's going on, brother?
Hey, how's it going? Everything is going good?
Everything going good, man. Everything going good. I'm happy we finally had an opportunity to get you on the show. We've been trying for a couple of years now, right?
I'm not sure.
Shine Dye introduced me to you, and we've been trying to get you on the show, and you said you wanted to wait until your album was ready. And then Lynn reached out to me and was like, yo, Jack, he's ready. And in celebration of Black History Month, the first day of Black History Month, I thought, along with your album dropping today and you being on the cover of Living Blues magazine, let's do this here today.
All right, that's what I'm talking about.
So we got a lot to talk about, sir, but, you know, I want to start with your new label and the name of the new label. So what I would like to ask you before we go into your journey as a human being and in blues and everything like this, tell us your inspiration to start the label and why you named it Black Shucks Records.
Well, I named it Black Shucks Records after a mythical, it's a black dog with shiny eyes. And I just thought it would be real cool to have a record company called Black Shucks, so I called it that. I had a few other names that I wanted, but they were already taken. So I had to do my research and kind of came up with that one. And it's about my third record on that label. And, you know, I'm proud to say I have my own label and that I'm putting out records like I'm doing now.
Well, that's groovy. Yeah, that's groovy. Now, being as the and I ask, especially as artists who's made the transition from the old school analog and wax into the new realm of digi recording and digital downloads, how important was it for you to create your own label? And what was your thought process behind having ownership and control of your career?
Well, you know, when you own it, you kind of play what you want to play. You don't have people trying to tell you to do this or do that. And you can really be more creative, I think, as you have your hand on the button. And also, financially, it's a much better situation. For example, I don't have people sending me statements like I did, royalty statements, and counting them to be correct and all that. I know everything is up front because everything is coming to me. There's an old saying that, write your own checks and you'll be better off.
I like that saying.
Yes, sir. I mean, you know, and for us as a people, you know, it's always... Hold on 1 second, please.
Sure. Yo, it's live, good folk, and you are getting some good information from Big Bill. You need to be taking notes because this is experience talking. Can you dig it?
All right. Can you hear me okay?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. So, no, that's it. You know, I just thought it was very important to have my hand on the on the controls, and to do it my way and do it exactly the way I want to do it. So that's what I've been doing. Like I said, this is my third record, and each one of my records have been very successful, and I'm proud. You know, I'm proud to be doing it like I'm doing it, because you know all the guys that came before me. Even my daddy, he always had other people record them, and they had to trust other people to do the right thing and pay them the right kind of money that was associated with their recording. And a lot of those guys got beat and didn't get what they were supposed to get.
So right.
I just thought it was a good thing to do it this way.
Well, you know, and I'm happy you brought that up, because that my next question, based on what we were discussing, what did you learn from your father's career? And that's a big lesson, because a lot of those cats from his era, before his era, and even after the golden years of the blues, so to speak, those chess years were getting beat. You know, I just had a conversation with slight debate, I'll call it a discussion, with a couple of cats in the blues community, and you know, a gentleman was explaining that the type of person Lightning Hopkins was, he doesn't think he was manipulated. He thinks that he just figured he'd rather see the money up front, and that's it. And the way I look at it, based on experience and the study in the history, based on what you just expressed, they were manipulated, because if somebody explained to them honest business and the importance of owning the rights of your work, they would understand why a portion up front, but the bigger money later, made more sense than just selling it away. And is that something you learned on this route and from your father's journey?
Well, I learned it from my father's journey, and I learned it from a lot of guys that got taken.
Mm.
And, you know, out of all the records that my daddy recorded, he didn't own one of them. Not one did he own.
Wow.
He wrote the songs, you know, and he did the performances, but it was always somebody else that had ownership of it. And even today, you know, you would have to go to those people and ask for an audit to make sure that they paid the way they were supposed to pay, and that you got everything that you were supposed to get.
Mm.
Let's face it, some of these guys, I'm not saying they were dishonest, but they, you know, shouldn't. You know, they did things that maybe they shouldn't have.
Right.
And not giving the guys what they deserve.
Based on their work.
Based on their work. And of course, when these cats die, it even gets worse. Because then you got the family, the family, the offspring that really don't know they don't know the music business the way they should. Music business is it's a creature that you have to be involved with to understand the workings of it.
Mm.
And if you're not involved in it, I mean, on every level, if you're not involved with it, then you won't understand how it works. If you don't understand how it works, then how can you know when somebody's not being straight with you?
Mm.
So, you know, I mean, it makes me feel good, and I'm sure my dad would be proud that I'm doing it this way. And I like to see a lot more people, whether white, black, or whatever, red, yellow, whatever color they are, to take control. And there's an old saying that if you don't stand up and claim what's yours, somebody will.
You got that right. Now, I want to... Based on that, I want to segue to something, because yes, it does not matter whether you come from the Appalachians and you do what some people call hillbilly music, or if you come from Chicago and you do what they call Chicago blues. You should stand up for what's yours and what's your culture. I want to kind of ask you this question. Do you, based on standing up and claiming what's yours, do you feel that black people should say, hey, this is our tradition? Now, that statement does not say no one else can take part in it, because that's not what I'm saying. But do you feel black people can say, hey, this music is part of our lifelong tradition on this land?
Well, I think they should, because that is what the truth is. the truth is the truth.
Right.
And blues, you know, where did it come from? Where did it come from? Where was it? Where was it? Where did it all originate from? Who were the founding fathers per se? Who were the guys that laid it down?
Mm.
You know, I would say about 80 to 90% of it that was in the black culture. Of course, I think you had a few other guys that kind of did something back in the day, but you know, back in the day when sharecroppers and the slavery kind of thing and all that stuff was going on, that music was born, I would like to say, out of poverty, out of hard times, and mostly on plantations in the South and Mississippi and the poor people. I mean, you know, and let's face it, they were black, man. They had their french fries on the weekends. and they did things to try to uplift themselves and make themselves feel better.
Right.
Because life was so, so hard.
Right.
So, I mean, that's where it came from. It has gone so far from Mississippi, and, you know, my daddy, he left Mississippi and went to Chicago and started that, you know, was a big part of the Chicago blues movement.
Oh, absolutely.
And look, I mean, the guys from Britain, when they got their hands on it, British guys, Rolling Stones and cats like that,
mm-hmm.
They grabbed it and they ran with it because it was a sound that was tremendous, and it was dealing with the subjects. You know, I kind of like country music too, because of they dealing with stories and things about life and having no money and things like that.
Right.
And it was the kind of music that would uplift people and make them feel better.
Absolutely. I would go as far as saying country music is blues.
Well, you know, you can definitely tell it's very deep rooted in blues. Not only country music, jazz.
Absolutely.
I mean, just if you listen real closely, just about every genre of music is rooted in the blues.
Absolutely. I mean, I'd go as far as saying hip-hop is the direct descendant, both established out of poverty and disenfranchised, utilizing their resources to just get along.
Yeah, you know what I'm saying?
Yeah. Now, before we continue that part of the conversation, I do want to talk to you about Big Bill, because this is your platform right now. And you made it clear, you made three albums right now. Forgive me, I'm sure you get this question often. Your daddy revolutionized American music. That's just a given. He's the blues. He's the direct descendant of Son House and Robert Johnson. He took that to Chicago, revolutionized music. What was your introduction into the music business? Not the blues, the music business. Why did you wait for a period of time before you attacked it, or did you even wait?
Well, I did wait. I went to college. I got a degree. I was raised by my grandmother. She thought that was extremely important to get an education.
Mm.
And you know, I believe what she said, and I'm glad I did, because I wouldn't be able to do what I'm doing now if I didn't have that strong educational background.
Mm.
You gotta be a little bit smart out here doing what I'm doing, because there's so many hats that you gotta wear. I wear so many hats that it's ridiculous. I forget. I wear so many hats. Even sometimes putting that attorney hat on.
Wow.
And going after folks that are trying to take my music for free.
Right. Right.
So, you know, I believe in fighting for what's right, standing up for what's right, doing the right thing. And, you know, I remember when I put my first record out, it was being offered as a free download. And I talked to some of the guys over at Blind Pig Records and some other guys, and they basically said that there's nothing you can do.
Wow.
And I didn't, I said, well, I may can't do anything, but I definitely can try. And so I started studying just how to go after these people. And I did a really good job at kind of curving it away from me and taking it away from my income. You know, when you put $28,000 or more into making a record, it don't feel too good when somebody's offering it as a free download.
Absolutely not.
So, you know, I learned how to go after those guys, and I started reading the different laws associated with that, and I'm pretty informed about what can be done and what's legal, what you can legally do to protect yourself against that.
So, which makes a lot of sense. Yeah. Wow. So now you said you wear many hats. Oh, wait, before we get to the business aspect and what you're doing. So your grandmother instilled in you that education is important, and I definitely can relate to that, right? Because our families have a similar pattern. Both of our families started in Mississippi, ended up in Chicago. I just ended up in New York, right? So I get that. Now I want to ask you this. Did she or anybody that was helping her raise you kind of tell you not to go into music, or did you always want to? How did that bug come about?
Well, you know, when you got a father like Muddy Waters, you know, I guess like with every kid, you know, when you're young, you know, you're 6 and 7, every kid kind of wants to be like their father. If you got a parent that you're very proud of, there's something in you to say, I want to be like daddy. You know, you say, I mean, it comes to your mind.
Yep.
And I started playing drums and piano and all kind of stuff at a very young age, just trying to mess around with it. And I remember in college, you know, we have a little jam sessions, and, you know, I'll set my guitar up, and I'll be just playing guitar, and me and a drummer would just be playing, and we'll attract a crowd while we're doing it. That's how I got started. That's how I got the bug, per se. And then once my father passed away, I felt such a large void.
Mm.
I wanted to do something. I wanted to do something to, you know, kind of like a tribute to him. I wanted to do something to say, Dad, I'm proud of you, and I want to do a tribute record. And I did in 1999. I did Rising Sun on Blind Pig Records, and that was my way of just saying that I was proud of my heritage, proud of what my dad stood for. I was proud of his accomplishments. And because he, you know, he came, here's a man that came from a plantation, 25 cents a day, working, driving a truck, that went on to be known all over the world. And to me, that's not a normal kind of thing to do. That takes a hell of a man to do something like that.
Absolutely.
And even now, my father's been dead for so many years, but you wouldn't think so, because his music is so alive. So many people want to record his songs.
Yeah.
His songs are in commercials. His songs are on radio. I mean, just all over. You're bound to hear Muddy Water somewhere.
That's right. His pictures all over the place.
That's right. And people, you know, I thank God for the people that love him. They will never let his name die. He will always be remembered as long as this planet is round.
Mm.
As long as there's people on this planet, he will always be remembered. And to me, that's a heck of a thing to accomplish, because so many people are forgotten when they pass away.
That's right.
30, 40 years, it's like it never even was on the planet.
Mm.
You would never be able to say that Muddy Waters wasn't on this planet, because he laid it down heavy.
He sure did.
Yeah.
He sure did. And, you know, even to say that he, from a plantation to around the nation, that's really heavy, because it's unheard of. That's just really just the concept of going from this is before Jim Crow, right? Or about Jim Crow, all the way up to traveling the world. That had to be shell-shocking for him as well.
Exactly.
Did he share any of these stories with you?
He didn't share. We didn't talk about that kind of stuff. The brief encounters that my dad and I had together, he would tell me about how many people he took care of, how many people depended on him. And but we really didn't talk much about the music. We didn't have to. You know?
Yeah, I understand. It was there. It was present.
It was there. And my dad was such a musician that it was. I don't know. He even talked like when he talked. You hear him talk sometimes. Feel like almost like he's singing. You know, he had a certain cadence to the way he spoke.
But that's great. That means he lived and breathed it.
He lived and breathed it,
mm.
That's putting it lightly.
Right, right. Well, you know, I want to talk about a song of yours that I beyond identify with, to the point my entire family identifies with this song. Because in my household, as of now, we take the traditions of our elders and we make sure we have meals together. My wife makes dinner, I make breakfast. And I had this experience. And I had the experience is that I'm making my playlist. And I said, well, you know what? I'm going to play the Morganfields in a row, right? I'm going to play all of y'all in a row. And I came across a song by you that I had to play, because this song represented one of my Saturday mornings. I think you know what song I'm talking about. No Butter for My Grits.
You didn't say that, did you?
What? I played it. Now, I lived that. Now, how did you come up with this? Because that's the blues. And those of you in the audience that don't understand how that's the blues, this is what I'm saying. This is part of the tradition. We have grits in the morning. Walk us through the inspiration of that song, please.
What was the inspiration?
Yes.
Well, it was a truth. It was true. I started my breakfast one morning, and you know, I thought it was Buddy in the refrigerator. And I got kind of in the middle of it and realized I didn't have any. And that was a problem. My breakfast wouldn't be complete with that. So, right about that journey, I left home and I went around to several stores trying to find it. I even went next door to my neighbor and tried to borrow something.
That's the blues, and that's great songwriting. And see, that's what I think is missing in some music that's called or being labeled as blues. There's more to it than shredding or dressing up as if it's the 20s or all these different other things. It's songwriting. It's story. That we walked through that moment with you. You know what I'm saying? Now, with that being said, let's shift gears to Bloodstains on the Wall. Talk to us about this album, how it affects you. What's the inspiration?
Well, you know, of course I was inspired by what was going on in the world today, on the streets. So many lives are being lost. So much blood is being shed. And that was probably my biggest inspiration in kind of putting that thing together. I don't know. I just wanted to voice a little bit about that. And then I got a call from some Fox TV network. They wanted me to write some music for the TV series called Shots Fired. So that whole thing kind of inspired me to put together that record, and I put that record together. Even though all the songs aren't necessarily about, you know, I got one song about my mother. You know, my mother passed away about a year ago. And how it feels when you lose someone you love. Of course, I could relate to some other mother,
right?
Some other person losing somebody they care about, and that's probably one of the worst feelings that to have is to lose somebody that you really love. And I'm not talking about a girlfriend. I'm talking losing somebody to death.
Right.
That's a pretty deep thing because you never hear that voice again.
Yeah,
That voice is silent forever, and that's a heck of a feeling.
Well, you're right.
To have a voice that you're used to hearing, and all of a sudden, it is silent, and all you have is the memories. To kind of inspire you to keep going, but yeah, that was kind of my motivation though.
I dig it. Now, I see you produced it. You also did the artwork. So this is part of the taking the ship by its horns and making sure it's presented the way you envision it.
Exactly. Yeah, I sat there and I actually had to teach myself as a learning curve. But I was able to get in there and put together all the artwork and just I did everything with the record. And this is the first one that I did, you know, I did everything. Music, artwork, just everything I put together. And the presentation is exactly the way I wanted it to be that way.
That's what's up. And I hope you guys are paying attention because a lot of people are leaning towards doing that. Some may, I don't say be scared, but are not fully confident. And, you know, I can't speak for the others. I don't know what they're doing. But you should take some notes because it sounds like it's very liberating.
Sounds like what? No, I'm sorry.
It's very liberating to do it this way.
Well, it's, It is. I tell you, I wear a lot of hats. All of a sudden, I wore the graphic design hat. And that sounds like a hard hat to wear, but it's not really. You just got to learn programs that deal with that and how to put things together. That's all. So I took my time. It took me a little bit longer than I wanted to take, but I took my time and I learned, and then I put it together.
Now, I see that you're on the cover, issue 246, volume 47 of Living Blues. How does that make you feel, brother?
I'm sorry.
On the cover of Living Blues, how does that make you feel?
Wow. I'm still feeling that one. Living Blues is one of the biggest magazines in the country, also overseas, too. So to be blessed with a chance to be on the cover, I'm still feeling that one. That was a very good feeling. Very proud that I was chosen for that. But, you know, I've been doing this thing here going on 20 years now.
Mm.
Not quite 20 years, but a long time. That's my first cover with Living Blues.
Mm.
So it made me feel pretty good. Feel like I wasn't forgotten, that people still remember me. And there's still life left in my career.
Mm, I hear that. I really understand that. So now let me ask you this.
You sound like you're a player. You play?
I play a bit. Yes. Yeah, I do, sir. Yes, I do.
Oh, go ahead. I didn't mean to interrupt you.
No, it's okay. You caught me off guard. People don't usually ask me questions, so you caught me off guard.
That's all right.
How's your songwriting and album, putting together your album process? Because it seems like you like to take your time in between albums. Is there a reason for that?
Well, taking your time is better than rushing.
Mm, okay.
And that's with anything you do. Like my pops, they say, take time. You know, the old folks, where they're like, take your time, don't rush it.
That's right.
Even when you're playing, if you're a player, when you play the blues, you take your time. And you let it breathe. You know, you pick those pockets to put things in, and you put the pockets to put the voice in. You take your time.
Mm.
And it comes out. It comes out where people can actually feel what you're doing. And, I mean, you can tell when somebody's trying to throw in something. And my daddy's always saying, blues is not something that you want to throw at people. You want to serve it to them like a fine dish.
Mm.
So you take your time. I remember this guy was kind of working with me for a lot of years, a guy named Brian Bassetti. And he's a great guitarist, man. And he would always tell me, take your time.
Mm.
Thing at one time. Take your time. So that's one of the things I learned as I got better. Just take my time and try to express myself a little better. We both know that blues is a feeling.
That's right.
It's all about a feeling. So if you take your time, you can kind of, create that feeling, capture that feeling, and pass it on to your audience.
Mm. So do you play acoustic blues at all, or you just straight electric?
Well, I do some acoustic stuff. I started out doing acoustic stuff. I taught myself how to play some of that old Robert Johnson stuff and the Walking Blues and the Rolling Stone and all that stuff, you know, that Catfish Blues. And I mean, I taught myself that first before I started venturing into like full band on some of them. So I can play it. I used to sit down right before every show, you know, and start my show out with a couple of acoustic tunes. But I don't know. People seem to like my energy. They seem to like me to stand up and move and shake it and lay it down heavy, you know.
I dig it. You got to give them what they're coming for.
That's right. On Friday, Saturday night, they want to see it. They want you to get it. You know, they worked all week long, and they want to release it. You know, the better thing is to release is just dance a little, move your feet. If you can't dance, get out there and move.
That's right.
You know?
I dig it. So how do you feel about the terrain of blues right now as a business for the artists, though, in terms of commercial sales? You know, does it look promising to you? Is it good? Do you think that it could be better?
Well, it could be better, as we all know that generation is getting thinner and thinner.
Mm.
Hence, if the blues is going to stay alive, we have to find a way to touch the younger generation. And I actually tried to do that on one of the songs on this record called "Hold Me, Baby." I collaborated with a hip hop producer. He's a genius. I think he's literally a genius. His name is C-No. They called me Honorable C-No.
Okay.
I worked with him, and he is absolutely incredible. I don't know how he did what he did, but he actually, you know, he said, "Sit down, Bill, and send me something." I played him something. He grabbed it, and he started working his magic with it.
Mm.
Well, we know we had that song, "Hold Me, Baby."
Mm.
Well, I think the blues has a future. But I think we got to keep in mind that things have changed, and blues need to evolve. It can't be like it was. Everything evolves.
Right.
Cars that we drive. Look at the big iron cars that used to be.
That's right.
And look how things have evolved into the streamlined kind of cars that really gas efficient and really slick looking with some of these cars they're making them. Even though I still like the older cars, I still like those bodies. Look what is selling. It's the new kind of cars that are selling more than the old. So things change. Everything evolves. But we as a people evolve.
Right.
You know? And I think blues has to do the same thing. It has to evolve. It can't stand still. It has to evolve if it wants to stay alive.
So we have, I don't want to say we have to, because when you say it evolves, I think of Motown, right? When they started, their music was really, really from the South Church, doo-wop-ish, old Negro spiritualist, and as time went on, you hear the progression. So you're saying blues should kind of, you know, lean less from the one guy or one woman and one guitar to, you know, let's get funky.
That's right.
You said that's right. So is there room for the traditional? Because some people like to play the traditional style of blues. And it's hard to say traditional because, as you and I know, so many regions that have different styles. But so I say traditional from the old school, like traditional hip hop would varies, but we understand. Is there room to have that style along with a more modern or current feel?
Absolutely. Absolutely. There's a lot of room. You know, and when it comes down to it, if you're trying to commercialize it, you have to think about what people like. You can play what you like, and you're supposed to, you really are, you're supposed to play what you love. But if you want to be commercial, you got to understand what other people love too, and try to play into that, into that that ballpark per se.
Right.
It's just like I think Lionel Richie is a smart cat.
Absolutely.
Yeah, he went from you know, the Brick House, Commodores, that kind of arrangement to some other kind of thing, and then lately, you know, not too long ago, a year or so ago, he put a country, got with some of the country guys. And with big success. He took a look at what was going on and what people like, and he tried to cater to what people like. It's like me, I love music. I love all types of music.
Right.
I love jazz. I mean, I love hip-hop. I love it all. I love music. Music makes the world go round.
Absolutely.
But the kind of music I make is what I really love, but I do try to cater it to what I think other people might enjoy.
Right.
No butter for my grits, that thing.
Right. You know, that's a living testament. So if you, well, you do have the opportunity. What is, I was going to say, if you have the opportunity, what would you say? But we can do it right now. What would you tell an up-and-coming artist, regardless of the age, what would be your first thought to give them as encouragement or advice?
Well, I would tell them to learn, be well-learned, to learn a few different styles. And once they get all that stuff under their belt, then try to take that and create something that represents them, per se. Something that they really like. I mean, for example, when I started out, I said I wouldn't be, I said it didn't make sense to jump in and start playing blues like modern blues. I said it made sense for me to go back to the beginning and learn the roots.
Mm.
So I would say get your foundation together, just like building a house. You want a strong house, you put up a strong foundation. Just like building a marriage. You want a good marriage, you have a strong foundation.
Absolutely.
It's important to have a strong foundation before you can move on and do something with it. So I would tell them, get your foundation together first.
Mm.
And when that happens, you got yourself something. Make it strong. Learn all you can. And that's part of the foundation.
So now, how long were you playing blues specifically? Because you've always played music, and I think it's safe to say that you've always played all styles of music, from what was popular at that time to everything. How long was it from you performing blues to recording the first album?
It was a while. It wasn't overnight, man. It took me. I was a slow learner, you know. I don't know if having a family and having kids and stuff made it where I had a limited amount of time to put into it, but I seem to take my time with things, and I try to learn it right. So I want to say it took me about 8 years, man, before I recorded my first record.
Mm.
And that's 8 years of paying the dues of, you know, playing around, putting together little bands, and going out, you know, playing for little or nothing, just to get yourself together and get familiar with what you're doing.
Right.
Also, spending time, what I call woodshedding, spending time to you alone, trying to learn lick by lick. I remember trying to learn walking blues, for example.
Mm.
And it was really complicated to me. And so, but I would play the record and I would listen to like everything that happened between that 1, 2, 3, 4, boom, I would stop it. I would learn everything within those four beats.
Mm.
Start it again. Once I learned, I wouldn't go any further until I learned everything within those four beats. And then I put it back on and another four beats, stop it. Learn what happened between those four beats. And that's how I learned.
Mm.
A little bit out of time. Sometimes it would take me, I remember it would take me, it might have took me 2 months to learn how to play that song.
But by the time you got it, you got it.
I got it now. I can pull the guitar right now without even warming my fingers up and lay it on you. I learned it. You know, it's something about when you learn stuff slow and learn it right, you don't tend to forget it as easy.
Right.
Not like cramming, you know?
Absolutely. Absolutely. And rushing. Now, in today's...
If you learn it right, it becomes part of your foundation.
Right. Right. And this is, see, thank you, because this is what I would like to ask you. In today's era of everything coming just quickly, right? Just a ridiculous turnaround, or at least the concept of things turning around so fast because of the medium and everything like this. Do you think that art that you're describing, the taking the time to build our foundation, is being lost in translation?
Well, I think we know what's good and what's not good.
Mm.
You're going to always have stuff that ain't so good. And you say, why it ain't so good? Probably because they rushed it. Probably because they went a little too fast.
Mm.
But so, you know, quality is, I think all Americans, all people like quality stuff. I know I do. I try to buy the best sheets to put on my bed. I just like quality. I like to buy nice clothes that'll hold together over a period of time.
Mm-hmm.
Not just in a few machine washes and bang, it's gone.
Right.
So quality. When it comes to music, it's the same thing. Quality. And we all know what quality is, and quality is quality. Period. So I'm into that. I'm into trying to make things good, to make them really good. They seem to last longer that way. It's not like a fly-by-night kind of thing.
Right, right. I agree. And, you know, I also noticed that not only are you doing soundtracks and scores, but you're acting as well.
I am. You know, it took me a minute for that to hit me. I was on the set, and they said, well, Bill, you know, we had the music. I came in, I flew in early, and I did the music in the studio. And then they said, well, you're going to come back to the set later tonight, and you're going to, what you just created, you're going to do it.
Mm.
I said, okay. So I went back to the room. I said, Herbert, send me what we did. So I could try to sync my mind to what I was. And I did a good job at it. I was able to sync up real fast. Well, I ain't going to say real fast. I spent the rest of that night and early the next morning. I think they brought me to the set about 11 o'clock at night because we did a jig joint scene.
Mm.
And we went from 11 at night to about that morning. I remember seeing the sun come up.
Mm.
All night long in that little juke joint. And so I realized that, you know, after the end of that, you know, I said, well, I just did some acting.
That's right.
And so, you know, it went so well, they actually called me back for another episode. So I did episode 2 and episode 4. And that was my second time because I did something in Banshee.
Mm.
I did a kind of the same thing I did in Shots Fired. And so I realized that I was getting a little bit of acting under my belt. So it's all good.
Absolutely.
It's all good. And I don't know. I like a good challenge. I've always have. And it was kind of challenging. And I went for it. And I did pretty good.
Are you looking to do more acting, and when I say more acting, moving out of the juke joint and playing a musician and like character acting and things of this nature?
I would love to do that. I got one of my friends, Tom Waits. I look up to him. I think he's a musical genius also. He's got that real raspy kind of voice, man. And that's what Tom is doing. Tom is doing... His wife is a string playwriter, And Tom is actually appearing in a lot of little things.
Mm.
That would be something that, you know, to look forward to if I could venture to that market a little bit.
Well, you know the saying, from your mouth to God's ears, when you put it out there, you don't know what's going to happen tomorrow.
That's it. And I'm very positive, and I'm putting things out there in the universe all the time.
I dig it.
I believe that all things are possible with the right elements around you.
Indeed. I just want to first and foremost thank you for your time and honoring this program to just sit down and chop it up and talk about the blues with me.
Well, I want to thank you for taking the time to talk to me, too. It takes two to tango, remember?
I dig it.
Yeah, I want to thank you, and I want to say hello to all the listeners out there. I tell them, and I want to say to them all, just keep supporting live music. If you get a chance, go out and support the guys out there doing it. Because, you know, that's what makes the world go round to me. And we need a lot more of that in the world today. May our world become a better place.
Absolutely. Y'all know what's going on. This is Jack Dapper Blues on WFDU HD2. We've been talking with Big Bill Morganfield. And we wasn't just discussing his new album. We discussed one of his old albums, and we discussed his journey. And it will be archived. But if you didn't listen, you'll be the last to know where it's going to be archived, because you should have been here.
Here you go.
But I want to thank you. And I want to play one of your songs as we leave this segment. But I just want to thank you again, and we want to get you on the show next time you're available, and we can continue the dialogue.
All right. God bless you, okay?
God bless you too, Big Bill.
All right. Thank you. Bye-bye.
Take it easy. All right, y'all. I'm going to end this segment with a cut from Big Bill's new album, and the cut is going to be the title song of the album. Don't worry. We're going to get into more Big Bill in the later segment. This is Bloodstain on the Wall.
Torn to pieces, blood stains all over the wall. Sheets and pillows torn to pieces, blood stains all over the wall. I know I wasn't here when I left this morning, didn't leave a phone out in the hall. Well, better come clean, baby, I'll soon find it out. Texas gonna be hanging around my door. Oh no, what it's all about. So stained on the wall. Well, I know I wasn't injured when I left this morning.